Our sound technician has brought me up to the stage in order to welcome you to the 8th annual Parsons College Wall of Honor ceremony. We're honored to have such a great turnout for this event to recognize members of our student body who have gone into their chosen professions and have made a mark not only on Fairfield, the state of Iowa, on our country, and in the world. My name is Dave Neff, and we welcome you. Please join me with an opening prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for the vision of Lewis B. Parsons in founding a college in Fairfield, Iowa, 1875. We thank you for the faculty and staff who shared their knowledge and gave vision to the students. Raising their own bar a little bit higher was a good thing to do. We thank you for this class of 2016 and what they have contributed to their chosen field in the United States and the world during their careers. Keep all safe as they journey to their home. Amen. At this time, I'd like to welcome our mayor. Last night, he was Burgermeister for Oktoberfest, Mayor Ed Malloy.
Thank you, Dave. Good morning, everyone. Welcome back to Fairfield, and of course, I see obviously a lot of our Fairfield residents in the audience who keep that very precious connection to Parsons College alive year-round in our community, and we really do appreciate that and appreciate all of the work that this great panel does each year to put on this wonderful event and to bring back those people whose lives were shaped and formed here in Fairfield at Parsons College and went on to great prominence in their lives. It's always very wonderful to read about those that are being enshrined and everything that they've contributed and their reflections about how important that period of their lives was in forming what they eventually went on to do. So congratulations to all of the Wall of Honor inductees and to everyone coming back, and I know that you'll enjoy this weekend. I was just remarking to Dr. Tree that it seems that every year that you have this, we have one of our Chamber of Commerce weekends. So thanks again for bringing the great weather too. Fairfield is doing quite well, making a lot of progress. Within the last year, we opened up a new recreational facility that is attached to the Roosevelt School, where our main hub of recreation is. This was a recreational center that had three gymnasium floors and a walking and running track around it. A beautiful facility. I hope you get a chance to at least just peek in and see what that is. These are really the first public gyms that have been built in Fairfield in decades and decades. So we were very proud of being able to get that done. We've had, again, continued strength in our economy. One of our largest manufacturers is adding a 70,000 square foot addition, the Dexter Apache factory, who make commercial laundry here, one of our oldest, most distinguished businesses in the community. So we're very happy and very pleased to see that going on. We're seeing a lot of growth and expansion south of the city. Highway 1, as it goes out towards the Highway 34 bypass, which opened about 10 years ago, and the development that's taking place down there, both in the commercial sector and in the residential housing sector, is very strong for us. Our unemployment rate in the county is hovering just a little over 4%, so things are very good there. And we received some very interesting news just a couple of months ago when we received the mid-decade U.S. Census report on population, and Fairfield showed a growth of 4.5% in the first 5 years of this decade, and it made national news. The USA Today covered the story that the Des Moines Register had covered, again, because it was the strongest growth that was shown in Iowa, but also very, very atypical for a small rural city to show that type of growth. So we know we're on the right track in a lot of different things within our community, within our city. The legacy that Parsons has here is one that we will always protect and cherish. So again, thank you all for coming back and for all the contributions you have made to our community. We will continue to be good stewards going forward. Thank you all again very much, and enjoy your weekend.
Thanks, Dave. Thank you.
Thanks.
At this time, I would like to introduce my partner in crime, one of the visionaries that had this idea, John Blackstock, as co-chair of our Parsons College Wall of Honor. John Blackstock.
Just a couple brief words here. Number one, this is year number 8. At the end of today, there will be 79 distinguished, prominent, successful Parsons-affiliated student alums on the wall to the south. We are so proud of that. We're so proud of the program. We have on the board 2 more years left. There will be nominating forms in the upcoming e-newsletters. We want to congratulate those who made the trip to Fairfield, which is not an easy place to get to. This will not be our biggest Wall of Honor gathering, but I can tell you from meeting and talking to everybody at the country club last night at the informal gathering, this might be the livest wired class we've had in quite some time. Lois Stofflick, whatever her name is, who you will meet and learn a little more about later. She not only brought her family of, 12, 13, but I think she brought half of the state of Iowa with her also. So I encourage you to, number one, while you're in Fairfield, visit some of the neat, great restaurants and scenes and sites around town here. It's really great. And secondly, I really, really encourage you to meet, talk to, and engage and exchange with this year's Wall of Honor class. They are truly a unique and interesting group. And with that, I pass on to the show, Mr. Dave Neff, the guy who none of this would be happening or accomplished without his participation. So thank you all for being here.
Seven years ago on this weekend, we inducted the inaugural class. We have with us today past inductees to the Wall of Honor, and I'd like to recognize them at this time. At the end of the list, I will ask for the house lights to be raised so all can stand and you can show your appreciation to those previous inductees. Class of 2010, Dr. Biff Coomer. Class of 2011, Coach Bob Spencer. Also of 11, Dick Reese. 2012, Dr. Kay Ferguson, Lee Kane, and myself. 2013, Dr. David Harding, Larry Litwin, Vera Price Young. 2014, Gene Copeland, Dean Hunhold, and 2015, Richard Tallon. If I could have the house lights up, please, and ask you to please stand and be recognized. This year, we have the 8th outstanding class to share with you. As John said, we will announce up and coming for 2017 and the nomination period in an upcoming newsletter on that. Next October, this induction, our committee will be reviewed by Dr. Robert Tree, who's on stage with us, John Braidwood, who is watching from New York, upstate New York, John Blackstock, and myself. Review and consider these names, and then we'll come to a final consensus, and nominations will be in the summer announcements. The summer newsletter. As I mentioned before, a vision for this ceremony was shared with us by John Blackstock, 64, who was just at the podium. He is also the editor of the Parsons e-newsletter. And with John and his wife Rhonda, who helped register you, it's a dedication of love to produce those. But any ideas, any suggestions, any stories, please forward them, because it's most important that the news be current on this. The recommendation for Parsons College Foundation was made by John Braidwood, class of 68, at an all-class reunion in 2003. Since that announcement of the foundation fund, John has worked to raise funds along with others to help construct this facility, total dollars from alumni, faculty, and staff are in excess of $225,000 to make this building a reality. So Parsons, you have made a mark on the community, even though we no longer have an active facility. You'll find the names of many of the contributors in the Brickyard, which is a donor piece coming in the other entry doors over there just outside that entrance. Nancy Wirtanen brought the recommendation to form an alumni association to a reunion, and there's currently over 3,400 names. As Mr. Trump would say, I said 3,400 names of alumni in a database. Dr. Dean Russo, as a faculty member, became our 3,000th listing, and that was in 2013. This is the heart of our alumni association. Nancy's assisted by Doug Marion and Ken Rice in managing the information and development of a website, and I would be remiss if I didn't say the direction of the e-newsletter is very important to get out to folks. So if you're not a subscriber or a member on that, please let us know. Dr. Tree, who is on stage with us, he's been a sounding board for the evolution of the entire process. We'll be forever indebted to these individuals who have given so generously of their time and talent. Without their energy, their enthusiasm and passion for these events, support and opportunities would not be happening. Please join me as I ask each of these individuals to stand and recognize them with a warm round of applause. Dr. Tree. We have faculty members and staff members who are in attendance today. You just met Dr. Tree here, and I'll read a few other names that are in attendance. On stage with us, Ray Hamm was assistant basketball coach and admission staff. I was in physical education. Bob Spencer is down here, women's basketball coach. Dr. Biff Coomer, intramural director. Dr. Tree, who you've met, and Vera Price Young, who is also in the audience. And so we still have faculty and staff who are engaged and involved in making this happen. Our most recent graduates, the final class was 1973, and Ray, who is here, Pat Ahrens-Peck, is also in our audience, and the class of 73, thank you for your support. We've been very fortunate with the staff and administration of this facility in coordinating these events, and without their help, it probably would not go as smoothly as we've been fortunate to have. We have some new faces helping us. They've been very cordial in welcoming us to make this happen. I would be remiss if I didn't mention two additional names. There are two ladies that greeted you either at the country club or at this facility this morning with registration. They are our brides, John's wife, Rhonda, Rockin' Rhonda from St. Louis, and Sherry Pye, Cherry Neff, Blau Neff from Fairfield. So ladies, we greatly appreciate all you've done to help support and put up with us during this time. Thank you, ladies, very much. Now the moment you've been waiting for the 8th annual induction of the Parsons College Wall of Honor. Our procedure, we will call the presenter to the podium. And after brief remarks, you will be, as a presenter, invited to sit with us in these chairs. And then we will call the inductee to the wall, to the Wall of Honor, to come up and have a few moments to share with you. And then with the assistance of Dr. Tree, Ray Hamm, John, and myself, both the inductee and the presenter will move to the middle of the stage, and we'll have a photo that will be available. We will get sent to you. And then you'll be escorted to the chairs. We'll start from this side and move across, and you will remain there until the end of the ceremony. We are blessed to have a facility that we can share with you at this time. Without further ado, our first inductee, Dan Breen, class of 71. When Dan was an outstanding basketball player in the early 70s, he had no idea of the impact he would have on girls basketball in Fairfield over the next 33 plus years. To present Dan to the Wall of Honor is his friend, Ron Hunterdoss. And I want to share that Ron is much younger than I, as I was his track coach at Parsons. And then he got to coach our daughter onto a state qualifier there.
Good morning. My name is Ron Hunter Doss, as he said. I'm a lifetime Fairfield resident and a 1972 graduate of Parsons College. When Dan Breen asked me to introduce him for this honor, I asked Dave Neff and Ray Hamm how to handle this effectively. Basically, they both said to keep it short and just give a few positive remarks about Dan. When they told me that I needed to make positive remarks, I determined very quickly that this could be the shortest speech on record. I do have a few things to share with you, however, and I'll let you be the judge. My first encounter with that skinny junior college transfer from Lorain, Ohio, was a pickup basketball game in the high school gym over there, late summer of 1969. After that game, I determined that there was not enough gauze, band-aids, braces, or splints to keep me playing basketball against Dan in his no ambulance, no foul attitude. I also determined that Dan was going to need a special tool belt attached around his uniform to house his hammer, hacksaw, drill, vice grips, and other tools of the trade he called defensive prowess. If that's positive, then I have a few more things. During an intramural track meet back in the day, Dan jogged the third leg of a mile relay, giving me a 1/2 stride lead against some Olympic hopeful from Kenya, expecting me to win the race. Needless to say, that did not happen. Dan and I coached track together for over 25 years after we both graduated. And for every single one of those 25 years, at least once a year, he would come over to the high jump pit while I was coaching my jumpers and mention to them sarcastically that they needed to put the jump into the high jump. Also, there are the constant remarks about the short inseam on my pants, plus the constant braggadocio about his superior golf game compared to mine. Now, if you want to believe that Dan Breen was one of the fiercest competitors in Parsons history, that's up to you. Actually, being a Fairfield native, having seen many years of Wildcat basketball, that would be the conclusion I would come to. I saw him for quite a few years. I have three grown children that would tell you that Dan Breen was one of the best teachers in the high school. My oldest actually does a very accurate impression of Dan, which I've heard is the highest form of flattery. I could say more, but I have to be honest with you now. Dan is a dear friend of mine. I'm eternally grateful that Dan wanted to cross the Mississippi to attend a 4-year liberal arts college in Fairfield, Iowa. When I shared with you that Dan and I coached girls track together for 25 years, I didn't tell you that Bill Moore, another Parsons graduate, was also part of that track staff during all those years. That is a part of my life that I will always treasure. Three Parsons College graduates, over a quarter of a century coaching girls track in Fairfield, Iowa. However, as Dave mentioned, Dan's greatest achievements of coaching occurred on the basketball court. I'm not going to go through all of them because there's just too many, but I can tell you he was highly respected for his innovative ideas and his attention to detail. Dan was an outstanding teacher, and that is why he was an outstanding coach. He took both jobs seriously. In retirement, Dan started a very successful youth program that I helped with. And even at the younger level, he maintained that attention to detail. I'm not sure he will ever really give up coaching, because I truly believe if a kid needed help, Dan would volunteer his services. The crown jewel for Dan, and Mayor Ed Malloy mentioned this without mentioning Dan, was the $10 million swimming pool gymnasium project in which he was a lead man. His effective speaking skills, soft sell, and knowledgeable approach was instrumental in bringing the project to fruition. Parsons College was lucky to land Dan Breen for his last 2 years of college, but this town won the grand prize when Dan decided to live the rest of his life in Fairfield, Iowa. I feel blessed to call him my friend, and just as honored to introduce a great Wildcat and Trojan. Ladies and gentlemen, Dan Breen.
Well, I think I should thank Ron for that. That was very nice. What I really want to do is start by thanking, probably for all of the inductees today, the committee who does so much of the work and has done such a wonderful job over the years maintaining the legacy that we're all so proud of at Parsons College. So if we could just take a moment at the beginning here to just a round of applause for all the people. It's a very humbling experience for all the inductees and friends and family that were at the country club last night. If you thought about it, we all were talking about many dozens of people we knew that all deserve all kinds of recognition for things all over the country. This could go on and on. We have literally hundreds of people who could be standing here. And I feel very humbled that I was given the privilege to be here today. What I really want to do, and I'm glad I've had this opportunity, is I want to publicly be able to tell people exactly what I've had as a private conversation throughout my adult life. And that is, I sincerely have been grateful my whole adult life that I came to Parsons College, because Parsons College was a unique and wonderful place. It got people have these stereotypes, and people who've never were there or never saw it have ideas that simply weren't true. When I came to Parsons College, I had Dr. Tree among them, a staff of people and professors unequaled anywhere else I could have gone to school, and I had opportunities to go other places. They were fabulous. I had access to those professors that I wouldn't have had anywhere else, and I did here. It put me in a position where the intellectual curiosity and the growth that a liberal arts college is supposed to do, Parsons College delivered it. And one of the most important things I ever decided was the day I decided to come here. And I'm not saying that because I'm here today. I'm saying that because that's in my heart, that I always realized this was the best thing I probably ever did in terms of changing my life. I went to the right place. Parsons College and Fairfield are sort of one with me, oddly enough. I sort of think of that as together. So in a sense, I never left Parsons College. I stayed here, was always sort of part of the fabric of my life and the community, and I'll forever be grateful for that. In a sense, I realized when I got in my 63 Valiant and headed west that I had a chance to change my life. I had a chance to change the way I would be and how I would think and how I would conduct myself. And Parsons was the perfect place for that to happen. It was a transformational decision for me. Quite honestly, as I look back, I realized that I grew up in I guess you would call me a street kid, a little like a virile cat, that we just sort of lived largely unsupervised. Life was often chaotic, sometimes violent, and tense, and hyper-competitive, as Ron was alluding to. And I realized at some point there was no way to live, but I wasn't sure how I was going to change that. So unlike most people, I took the offer, the college scholarship, basketball issue, I took the offer that was farthest away and also seemed somehow appealing to me, something about coming here. And I got to admit, it was a cultural shock when I showed up. I had this moment when I first came here wondering, what have I done? It seemed so isolated geographically and so small. It's funny how I think now Fairfield, it seemed like such a small place. But the people at Parsons College in Fairfield were warm. They were inviting. They were reassuring. And it gave me a chance to become a much better person. Some people go to college and they think that's when you start to party and carry on and have all these things that you someday apologize for. That was essentially the way I probably lived before. I came here and this became the beginning of my adulthood. And I was surrounded by people that could really back that up for me and stimulate me. Some of the happiest days of my life, without any question, were my days when I was a student at Parsons College for all kinds of reasons. It made me more optimistic. It made me more confident. It made me more curious, all the things that would allow me to help serve other people in my professional endeavors later. And I know where that came from. I didn't bring it here. I acquired it here. And I will forever be grateful for that. So that transformation was as much Parsons College as it was myself. And it was as much the people and the professors and the people who lived in town. And I will forever be grateful for that. And I want to conclude simply by extending my thanks to all concerned. And I'm going to turn this over to David and have my seat.
Okay.
You bet.
Thank you very much. Congratulations. Bill Berger, class of 1950. There are all people who were born to be leaders, and there are people who are born leaders. Bill Berger was born to be a leader. Presenting Bill to the Wall of Honor is his friend and fraternity brother, Gene Copeland.
I'm not here to talk about all the lists of Bill Berger's presidencies and contributions. He is a man that is committed to a life of public service. In the Ledger this week, there were like two columns of president of this and president of that. He has been a good friend of mine, and he's a good friend to everyone. That's what makes him successful. He loves Parsons College and the Alumni Association. He's a spark plug for the vision of a joint venture with the Carnegie Museum. Some of his qualities are that he's patient, respectful. He shows up. He's a man of goodwill. He's imaginative. He's effective. Things get done without ruffled feathers. He's the oil that makes things work. He is easy to work with. He's a man of great faith. He and I both share a vision of working with labyrinths. I was the initiator for a publicly available labyrinth just north of the Methodist Church, and Bill is working on a labyrinth project now in his church in Florida. He's been a good friend of mine through two fraternities, or three fraternities actually, at Parsons College, at the Iowa Law School, and in the 34th Army Band, which I kind of view as a fraternity. And finally, we both had the benefit of the mentoring of one Dr. Tree. Anyway, there's only one disappointment that some of us have about Bill, is that he did not run for governor. So let us welcome Bill Berger.
Well, as was said before, I feel humbled to be here with this group today. I can't see anybody out there, and that bothers me. But I'm a firm believer that what you experience in college really shapes you. I came to Parsons simply because my folks moved here the year before I graduated. I didn't have any money, and I wanted to go to school here, particularly because there was a young lady that I was interested was going to be attending here also. So I came to Parsons, and I remember going to my first class with Dr. Wheelock, and it just scared the living something out of me because all this big stuff about the world and history, and I thought, man, I don't know what I'm into. But I want to stop there a minute because after I graduated, and then I went to law school, I was interviewing for a job as a trust officer in a bank. And they took me over to meet this lawyer that was on the board. And he looked at my resume and he said, oh, you went to Parsons. The first question he had for me was, did you have a tough time in law school because you went to Parsons? And you know, that has stuck in my craw for 60 years. And I vowed that Parsons College would never be something that was around my neck. It would be something that I would wear on my chest proudly. I had great teachers, and I think that was what really formed a lot of my desire. One of my teachers was a guy by the name of Dr. Hargis Westerfield. He was my freshman English teacher. And he kind of had a strange, his suit coat didn't seem like the shape, didn't work very well. But the thing he made us do was we had to read 15 minutes every night and write a paragraph 3 days a week when we met with him. Now, I thought this, I had never written before in high school. And this was a lesson I learned is A, to read and be aware of the world, and B, you have to write about it and communicate it. I want to tell you something interesting. If you knew Dr. Westerfield, or if you didn't, this man, I later determined in the early 90s, was in a regiment of the U.S. Army Infantry. This regiment had the longest time in battle in the Pacific theater of any U.S. regiment. This man was what we would call today was a sniper in the Army, and was one, and his commander, I happened to be where he was speaking, said he was one of the best they had. Dr. Westerfield published a lot of poetry, and you can go out and find it now. But the love of writing was so important. Another one, I've mentioned Dr. Wheelock, and you could go on for hours about the impact that he had in pushing and stimulating one's mind. And speaking of stimulation, I also learned that you have to make do with what you have, and then you just go from there and forget it. But I was in the band my freshman year, and Dr. Becker was our instructor. And we were so excited because we were going to get uniforms. Now, everybody knows that the rose and green is our colors. But Dr. Becker explained to us that, you know, in these universities and colleges, you don't always have matching band uniforms, as he brought out our blue and gold band uniforms. They had been acquired at a bargain, and they couldn't pass them up. My mentor, Dr. Tree, was so instrumental, and he just pushed you and made you study or want to study, and that was what I learned probably more my senior year than I did my sophomore and junior years. But all of these people all taught me to be better. And the final stimulus that I had as I was graduating, I was walking out of Fairfield Hall one day, and I ran into Dr. Dorsett, who was my economics professor. He was not overly impressed with my academic work in that class, and as we're walking and passing each other, he just looked at me out of the side of his face, and he says, "Bill, you think you'll ever mount a hill of beans?" I hope he was joking. These people, plus others, they formed my concept of what a community was, because we were a small community then. We were Parsons. We were probably about 900 students at that time. And it was that stimulus and that work that I have carried with me, or hope to carry with me, all my life. And finally, the other impact on my life was I did rekindle this relationship with a wonderful woman who's been my wife for 56 years and the mother of our four children. And she also is a Parsons grad and can speak the same words that I have. So today, I thank you. I am humbled by this award, and I just love to come back to Fairfield and be a part of this wonderful community. Thank you.
Jim Cornick, class of 64. They say you can take the man away from the farm, but you can't take the farm away from the man. Such was the case with Jim Cornick, who left briefly but returned to Iowa, carved a stellar career. Introducing Jim as longtime friend, Don Samuelson.
Well, Dave said to keep it brief, so I only brought just a few pages anyway. Before I start, I want to make one thing. This is about Parsons, and it should be. But that fraternity that Copeland talked about, the 34th Army Band, there's five of us here today. James Cornick graduated from Parsons College in 1965 with a Bachelor of Science degree. He was a member of Beta, 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 a National Biological Honor Society, Green Key, a Junior's Honor Society, vice president of his sophomore and junior class, and was a member of Sigma Phi Epsilon fraternity. Now, Jim was Sig Ep, I was Lambda Chi. Some people thought it was kind of unusual for one frat guy to introduce another, to recommend a frat guy from another fraternity. But you know what? If you're deserving, you're deserving. It doesn't matter, as in politics, which side of the aisle you sit on. If you're deserving, you're deserving, and no matter what your affiliation, and Jim is deserving. Thus, I don't think it is so unusual. Besides, I intend to nominate a Lambda Chi next year anyway. Upon graduation, he joined Meredith Corporation in Des Moines in 1967 after having worked for Standard Oil of Indiana. Meredith publishes Successful Farming magazine, and Cornick held various sales and marketing positions until he was named publisher in 1980, an office he held until his retirement in 2001. As manufacturer, he was responsible for strategic planning, budgeting, circulation, manufacturing, editorial direction, research, advertising, and overall profits. Now, I don't know how you could get much more under one umbrella. When he joined Successful Farming, it was rated the number three national farm magazine. Under his tutelage, it rose to the number one farm magazine in the United States with over 1.3 million readers. Even with all his outstanding credentials, the main reason for the committee to award Jim this prestigious award is his untiring efforts to advocate for children and adults with serious mental illnesses. He currently serves on the Iowa Mental Health Planning and Advisory Council to monitor the adequacy of mental health and services. His tireless efforts have led to some significant changes in the treatment and care of the mentally ill in our prison system. While carrying a heavy burden, he continues to crusade in government circles from local, state, and even federal officials. But he will tell you there's a long way to go. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure and honor to introduce a real-life crusader, Jim Cornick.
Thank you. It's great to be here. Don, I want to thank you for putting my name in nomination. Don himself is a graduate of Parsons College and a successful businessman, a successful soldier, and has a successful family life. And it is humbling to have a Lambda Chi nominate a Sig Ep for this outstanding honor, so I am humbled. And thanks to the Alumni Association for awarding me this honor. Allow me to introduce my wife and friend for 30 years, Sue, in the back row. Thank you for being with me. What does Parsons College mean to me? I will admit it had a significant impact on my life. Always throughout my business career, I had my Parsons College diploma framed and on the wall of my offices. And that also engaged in some very interesting conversations from time to time. And since my retirement in 2001, that diploma still is in my wall in the office at home. I enrolled in Parsons College in the fall of 1961, and there were 1,500 students at that time. 4 years later, when I graduated, there were over 5,000 students. So it was a period of tremendous growth, diversification, creativity, and activity. One thing Parsons did that was unique was introduce the trimester system, where students could graduate within 2.5 years if they chose to do so. As you heard before, Parsons was also a highly sought-after place to come for professors with PhDs, and they were highly paid. In my 4 years of college, in my classes, I only had one professor that did not have a PhD. These people made learning fun. There was also a Parsons College culture that went along with learning. We were entertained by the likes of the Kingston Trio, Sammy Kay, Pat O'Brien, Glenn Yarborough, Louis Armstrong, the Smothers Brother, the Four Freshmen, Fay Emerson, and the orchestras of Count Basie and David Brubeck. For many students, it was a college of second chance, and those who were given a second chance went on to achieve at very high levels. I can't prove it, but I would venture to say that probably on a on the basis that Parsons College graduates probably had more success than other comparable colleges. Please continue to find them and honor them. In my 20 years of publishing, of being publisher of Successful Farming Magazine, it was an exciting challenge. If you were a fan or ever a fan of Netflix and watched The Mad Men, that's how it was. We did accomplish a lot of success, and we had our failures too. All in all, we changed the way agriculture is, and we made big changes in agricultural publishing. But as I said, I think really what moved Don to nominate me was my ongoing work on behalf of the mentally ill. The hardest work I've ever done was to find mental health treatment for my bipolar son. Jeff tried hard to be more normal, but he finally gave up and ended his life on his 43rd birthday. With all the, in honor of Jeff's struggles, I have since been devoted to create more awareness of the mental health crisis in America. With all the violence we hear and see in the news today, we continue killing ourselves more often than we kill others. Nearly all suicides are linked directly to mental health issues. The latest national figures reveal annually there are over 41,000 suicides, and that's compared to 16,200 homicides. That means every 13 minutes, someone in America is committing suicide, and that compares to one person every 12 hours committing a homicide. It's the second leading cause of death among ages 15 and 34. People untreated with mental illness are 16 times more likely to be killed by our police. In Iowa, there are 126,000 who suffer from a serious mental illness. Per capita, Iowa ranks at the bottom of the number of psychiatrists, psychologists, and acute mental health beds for those people who suffer from mental illness. Government is closing our state mental institutions. Versus paying for mental health treatment, our leaders find it more cost-efficient to house our mentally ill in prisons and jails. As an example, in the Polk County Jail in Des Moines, 40% of its inmates suffer from mental illness. So we are balancing our books on the backs of the most vulnerable citizens. And to me, this is not a moral way to treat the mentally ill. It is hard, hard, hard work. But I am proud to stand up for those who are unable to stand up for themselves. I thank you for this honor. This plaque will be proudly displayed in my office at home beside my Parsons College diploma. And God bless those of you devoted to keeping Parsons College living in our memories. Thank you.
Bobby Harrison, class of 54. If Fairfield were casting for an all-time music man, they would have to look, they couldn't look past the name of Robert Bobby Harrison. This excellent trumpet player and co-founder of the local Dixieland band would be a top choice. Presenting Bobby is his son, Doug.
I will be presenting and actually saying a few words on behalf of my dad that he wrote down. First of all, our family is very appreciative and thankful of this honor, basically. Both my parents went to Parsons College, and I was a freshman at Parsons the very last year it was open, so it was a great experience for me, and it's sad it had to close at that time, because like everyone says, those were the best teachers I had in my college years. Okay. Basically, two facts are very important to my dad that really was why he appreciated and the importance of Parsons College. Number one, being in Fairfield and at Parsons allowed him to continue playing the trumpet while being involved with the 34th Army National Guard Band. The core of those friends and folks that he met there formed the nucleus of the Fairfield Dixieland Band, and he had over 45 years experience and companionship with those gentlemen, like Don and others. The other guys that would mention that just while I'm here are Art Pack in Fairfield, Bob Parkin, Larry Hanshaw, Merle Bates, and Ron Prill. Those guys were the founding members of that band, basically. And probably one of the most, when I was roughly 10, I kind of realized how big a deal this band was, the Army Band and just the Fairfield Dixieland Band, because it's kind of one of those moments you realize, you know, your parents, you know, they're doing something important. And in this case, this Dixieland Band in the mid-1960s represented the state of Iowa on kind of a tourist promotion, and they played their way from Iowa to California, and then they just kind of jetted back, but they were just stopping over it, playing Dixielands, promoting the state, and especially Fairfield. So it was quite an honor that they were chosen to do that, okay? The second main reason that my dad was appreciative of Parsons College is he was basically someone that was a pretty good athlete. Parsons was roughly had 300 students at that time, a member of the Iowa Conference, but he played all sports. And all of those sports he played were under the direction of O.B. Nelson, and everyone knows his basically legacy, okay? And the one story that my dad has told me a few times that involves O.B. Nelson and Parsons College football is I think it was his senior year, Parsons College had a black running back by the name of Lonnie Johnson. He was the only black player on the team. They were playing south of the border, and the opposing coach refused to play Parsons College because they had a black player. Okay, so you know O.B. Nelson, and he, you know, but Nelson says, okay, well, that's fine. If you want to forfeit the game, we'll be glad to take it. So they had a little standoff, and the game was played eventually, and Parsons won that game. So to me, in light of what's going on now, Parsons has always been, you know, a front runner of basically trying to give everyone equality. And I'm proud of that little story because I've heard that a few times. One other thing I'll mention about my dad, and just basically not so much about him, just about how he appreciates Parsons and it's basically alumni. When he had a surgical procedure 8-10 years ago in Cedar Rapids, which was successful, but it was more important to him telling me about the surgical procedure that the doctor that did it, his dad was a Parsons College grad. Not so much the outcome of this procedure, but that just the relationship meant a lot. So basically, we are very thankful, appreciative of this honor, and we'll get my dad up here, and thanks a lot, folks.
Thank you for the weather and the doggone good things, the way you treated most of us today, this following week. Thank you very much. It reminds me of when I was a real small kid and playing the Saturday baseball or basketball and playing and of the schools, Lincoln, Washington, and the other two that sat or in front of this crowd, not necessarily in the exact numbers, but there was a lot of good people came out of sports and good erasable stuff what they played with during that time. And I think back to the people that had to take and study. And there was one young man that I don't see him here, but you can tell him. And I know I'm not sure what his status is now. But he was, I think, one dick ahead of somebody in the Washington, Lincoln, and Logan tracks. And his name was Bob Baker. He was at Washington High School. And he was very good. He at that time probably was the number one basketball player in Fairfield, without any kind of mention at all. He was about 5'4" tall, and he liked to get in his basketball dribble and go out to where the red or the circle is out there, and he would try to make the wagon covet, and yet he would try to get it in 50% calculation, both sideways and length. But there were great people at that time that made things very easy for people to play basketball and also baseball and make it available to those who wanted it. And just the nicest things that ever happened to people who were running the making prior descriptions. And
yeah. And let's go take a picture.
Okay. There we go.
Oh, right up here.
We just don't make any laugh.
Dave Hubler, class of 60. Ironically, Dave Hubler's first job working in the student union and activities department transitioned into a successful career as an international authority on student unions. Dave, who passed away earlier this spring, will be presented by his son, Mark.
Good afternoon. How are y'all today? I want to thank, first of all, the Gillespies for nominating my father for this honor, and the committee for letting him have it. My father did pass away earlier this year, and Parsons had a huge impact on his life. As a little kid, I remember he was very proud of his yearbooks, and we went through them over and over and over. Parsons had a huge impact on his life. It did start him in the career as this director of student activities here, and he followed that up, went to the University of Illinois, became the director of the student union at the University of Maryland, where he had many fond memories. He also worked at the University of Chico State University in California. But he always talked about Parsons and how once he graduated with a degree in history, he came here as a professor and then really decided that working with students and working in universities was what he wanted to do for the rest of his life. And he always credited Parsons as the place where he formatted that. Working with the students here and working in this atmosphere made him decide that even though he had graduated, he never wanted to leave college. And Parsons was the place that instilled that in him. One of his greatest achievements at Parsons was in 62 when he met his wife, Tamara, and married her. She was at the sorority of Alpha Zeta Delta, and they played bridge a lot. But he always looked at that as, hadn't been here, he wouldn't have met her. And I was born here in 67 as well. So that was also his greatest achievement. The atmosphere here at Parsons always, again, made him the man that he was. My sister always talked about, she remembered pushing me in a stroller at a civil rights march that they had here in Fairfield. But the academic atmosphere always made him, challenged him to think progressively, to think critically, and he instilled that in his family. His daughter went on, she now is a professor at Kansas State University. And I went to college, but not as much as he probably wanted me to, but he always talked about how working in universities was what he always wanted to do and how Parsons was the place that instilled that in him. It was always in his memory. He always had sweatshirts, little Parsons footballs everywhere. Parsons always will live on in my family's history. And I want to thank you guys all for being a part of that. I'd like my mother to come up and accept the plaque for him. Once again, thank you very much for this honor. And although my father passed away earlier this year, of all the different honors that things that people have told me about him, he really, really would have been most touched by this honor from this university. Thank you so much for nominating him. Mom.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Fry Thomas Fieldhouse. This evening, Parsons College Wild Kittens will be playing the Raytown Piperettes. One of our starters is here with us today, Lois Stufflick Johnson, class of 71. Is that right, Coach? Okay. When your college coach labels you as one of the best girls basketball players in the world, not Iowa, not the United States, but the world, it's worth taking note. Here today to present Lois Stufflick Johnson to the Wall of Honor is that coach, the legendary coach, Bob Spencer.
I want to congratulate all of the recipients. And Bob Harrison, you were the most talented athlete in every way I have ever known. I know that Lois will recognize some of her teammates and her classmates, but Deb, Kathy, Joyce, certainly we're glad that you're here today. And any I've missed.
Beaver,
right. Also here today is Coach Bob Merkel, longtime friend who helped us at our basketball camps. We had 24,000 girls go through our camps over a 21-year period, and Sunday to Friday. None of those two-day camps, none of those one-hour camps where they have some pro come in and do the talking. We had our own pros, all Americans. And the person being inducted today is no exception. I would be remiss if I did not mention very young. When I returned from the Army, having gone there after 2 years at Parsons, when I came back, Vera asked that I help her with her programs for women, particularly in basketball. Her good friend and her daughter, Kay, her friend Kay McPherson Ferguson, are here today. My assistant for 8 years was Ray Ham. I could not have had a better co-coach. Bob Merkel, as I said before, one of the best coaches in the state of Iowa in high school, Southeast Polk, he hired Lois right out of Parsons College. They were together for nearly 20 years. Her husband, Howard, who as many of you probably know, his parents ran a hardware store for years here in Fairfield. So to speak, her husband, Howard, as with many of us, including my wife, Pat, has always been the wind beneath Lois's wings. as the song goes. I recruited Lois out of Kanawha High School in a cornfield. They had a track, dirt track, and she was involved in throwing the discus at the time, and also the shot put and other events. In high school, one time Lois scored 72 points. She was a good student athlete. I always recruited, which was not hard, even though I coached boys also and men. It was not hard to get good student athletes who also played basketball and who were coached by good coaches in high school, and every one of them made me look like a halfway decent coach. Lois Steflick Johnson graduated valedictorian of her class of over 500. Bob Merkel and Lois won the state high school championship. Lois is a member of the High School Girls Hall of Fame. She is a five-time All-American. Five-time. She played on the United States team in the Pan American Games. She and her husband, Howard, are recognized as two of the best officials in the Midwest, volleyball and basketball. Without further ado, I present to you Lois Steflick Johnson, extraordinary wife, mother, former student, athlete, teacher, coach, and friend, Lois.
Remember, David, none of that counts as my seconds, okay? I mean, he said brief. I got a little piece of paper. What's on it may not be brief, but we'll work on it. I want to thank my college coach. He's why I'm at Parsons. He's why. He is family, and he always has been family, and he's done a great job, and I appreciate it. I appreciate it. Came to, and even 50 years later, I get in the mail these envelopes with cute little things, and he never wastes paper. Every bit of this paper is written on with great thoughts from my coach and his wife, Pat, and everything. Coach was a great coach, and by the way, it's stuff like, you stuff a basket, lick a stamp, and one F in my name is all I want. And everything. Back to coach. It makes, I talk about nervous. I can play basketball better than speech. And everything. But anyway, coach was a great coach. But coaches push you. I just want to tell you. Yes, he ticked me off more than once. One time, he ticked me off so bad. We're playing Priory Town or someone. I was so ticked at him. I was went over to Mrs. Patrick, great woman, and she said, she gave me a shot of vodka, and she said, go back and play ball. That's the truth. I think I played pretty good that day, too, by the way. I'm not sure. Anyway, but I always had Grandpa Spencer to save me if Bob got out of hand, because Grandpa was my life, and we missed him all. And he would save me. He'd tell, son, back off her. and everything. Family is the big key here. Bob's family, Dick and Joanne and all the ones, we were like family. They treated us like family. It was great. But I go back to my story. One day, I'm a rookie person from Canal in the cornfield, six family or six kids, and along comes Bob knocking on our door, would you like to play basketball for me? And I go, yes, that would be great, because nobody else was knocking on my door. I only made third team All-State and everything, and never got to play in the state tournament, but Bob found me. And thank you to this day that he found me. So we went on to college and played college basketball camps. Went down to Lake Eufaula, Oklahoma, one of the first basketball camps in the United States. He took me with him. Rita McIntyre was in our camp. Yes, she was an art talent girl too. So I was getting memories. Came back to college, 4 years of college. And basically, I came from John F. Kennedy College, and Midwestern was closing, Kennedy was closing, so we all came to Parsons together, and that's where some of my teammates. Kathy Jensen is like a sister to me, and she was the wild kitten. And it was P-P-P-P-R, you know, P-P-A-R-S-S-S-O-N-S, Parsons, Parsons, Parsons. I still know that. That's why Parsons is in my heart. Parsons in my heart. And everything. After I basketball camps, Bob Merkel said, hey, would you like to come coach with me at Southeast Polk? And I'm going, yes. So I joined another family. So I took great care of me, Bob, Ben, and their kids, and I had a great time. And now I'm going to back up a little bit. My special, special husband, which allowed me to do all the coaching and stuff, starts off, I really didn't know I met Parsons. He graduated 73, the last class at Parsons. One day, the refs didn't show up. So guess who got the ref our game? My husband, which, hey, that guy, he's pretty cute, but I wasn't paying attention to him at the time. 2 years later, he comes to Southeast Polk. And the guy in the office says, I think you know this guy. He went to Parsons too. So we had lunch together. Then, that was like in 73, my goal was to win the state championship. So he chased me for 3 or 4 years. I said, if we don't win the state championship, I'm not marrying you. Finally, 1977, a special year, we won the state championship. Awesome, right, Coach? He's laughing. May, Memorial Weekend, we got engaged. October 15th, 1977, I married that special man. And between the two of us, we have a great family, which they're all here today. My oldest daughter, Nikki, and her family. Man, Mario, and she has 3 children, 6-year-old Mario, twins, 1.5 years, God bless them, Maverick and Isabella, and husband Mario, Amber, my second child. She is a kindergarten teacher, and she married Matt, thank you, Matt. And we have 2-year-old Oliver, September 19th, he was 2 years old, and his sister Lena came into the world on the same day. And the best of all, my son Shane. So I have a great family. That because of me coming to Fairfield, my life really started. And this is a great honor to be inducted. And I'm so happy for the committee to keep Parsons alive, because Parsons was good to all of us. And thank you very much.
Bill Larkin, class of 66. Bill runs a school bus service of sorts. He transports college teams and students to and from their sporting events via his charter, air charter business, and then has them back in class the next day. Bill will be introduced to the Wall of Honor by his friend and fraternity brother, Dick Barton.
I was asked by Bill to present him for this ceremony, and I asked him, I just needed one thing from him, and that was his resume and a few things that I could say so that I would be factual in what I tell you. Did I receive anything from Bill? No, nothing. So what you hear from me today will be both true and not true, but I'll say it anyway because it develops my storyline. I'm not going to go into all of his awards and things. I encourage you to read the program on his bio because there's way too much there for me to cover. Bill grew up in Grand Rapids, Michigan. He was recruited in 1962 to come to Parsons and play football and to become a Rhodes Scholar. I'm not sure who wrote this. Accomplishing one out of two is not bad. There's a long line of sports players that came to Parsons from Grand Rapids, and he was one of them. As a freshman, we were all nervous about entering college life. Some of us tried to search out advice. Here, Bill was waiting on the dorm couch for our wonderful house mother, Mom Gaiman, to seek out advice about how to be successful in college. Mom Gaiman told him, study hard, go to the library, and get straight A's. Well, that kind of ended that conversation. But then she said, have fun and enjoy yourself. Bill understood that advice and was back in the game. He enjoyed himself and gave a lot of harassment to people and got back as much. That's Mr. Larkin right there in the middle, being attacked. We all had to maintain certain grade point average to stay eligible for play football. Learning how to manage time between classes, football practice, football games. Some of the away games were 4 or 5 days away from the classroom. That was hard for us. But after a semester or two or three, most of us would get the hang of it and our grades would be in the safe range. Here, Bill is celebrating his good semester grades, probably a 2 point, with some of his private academic tutors. Brilliant, brilliant minds. Right there. Brilliant mind. John Blackstock. Phil Suarez. Fred Emdy. Gary Thomas. Ted Akerson. Bill, Joe Clark. I think I'll stop there, otherwise I'll disprove my theory about brilliant minds. Bill was a starting linebacker on the football team and was tough as nails. Does anyone remember Bill's nickname? Anyone? Magoo. In case you didn't know, he was named after the cartoon character Mr. Magoo, because when Bill took his glasses off, he couldn't see a thing. We used to hide his glasses and watch him stumble around, run into things. It was kind of paybacks. When the team would go on defense, the coach would call out Larkin, in at linebacker. Magoo would take his glasses off, put his helmet on, and run onto the field. You could see him squinting through his face mask to try to see who had the football. He couldn't see who had the football. If the action came his way, he would just start tackling everybody. You know, and finally he had a pile of bodies there, and the ball carrier had no blockers in front of him or nowhere to go. Somebody else would make the tackle, and we'd pull Bill from the pile of bodies. He'd straighten his helmet up and say, did I get him? I said, yeah, Magoo, you got him. Good. Let's do that again. That was fun. Bill was a respected student athlete and respected leader here at college. He is also a respected leader in the world of business and as a father and family man. Even though he didn't get the Rhodes Scholar thing, Bill did just fine at Parsons College. Actually, his Rhodes Scholar, I would say, is his equivalent is in his business world and what he's done rather than in the classroom. Here, Bill, Hub Hills, and myself just enjoying the day. In the evening, we had a little gathering and took the dates back to the dorm. We're going back to the house. I think Hub Hills and Bill was maybe racing me. I was in the old car. And they T-boned me at an intersection down at Briggs and 9th. Officer came. Had you boys been drinking? No, sir, officer. Probably smelled like a brewery. But we don't drink. He said, go home, get in bed, have a good night's sleep. Nice man, nice man. Bill doesn't drink now. His father was Irish. Mother was part American Native. He decided alcohol wasn't the best choice with his genetics. So he stopped drinking 36 years ago. And I say, good for you, Bill. He had some powerful connections at a young age. When the Army called, Hub and I, we were sent to Vietnam. And Bill got assigned to Germany to go entertain the Fräuleins over there. So I don't know what Bill had to do with that, but it seemed odd. Graduation came. And we all had to grow up and do something useful with our lives. I know it's a somber event, and the boys were just getting ready for the somber event. Some of us grew up sooner than others. Bill Larkin, my friend. Oh, wrong Bill. y'all remember Parsons Bill. But it's my privilege to present William Bill Larkin to you for the Wall of Honor Award. Thank you.
Morning or afternoon. I'm very thankful to be here. I'd like to thank the board, David, John. As was mentioned before, I was recruited to play football by Gary Nady. And the reason I was recruited is because Grand Rapids, Michigan had a long history of having young athletes come to Parsons. I have not kept up with all of them, but Lou Wilson's on the wall. Great football player. Joe Drake's spent his career in the West Coast in education, another good football player. John Matthews, distinguished career in Grand Rapids, heading the Board of Education, personnel department, along with a career at Steelcase. Those guys really paved the way because Gary Nady wouldn't have come to Grand Rapids without those quality guys. I spent a lot of time with those guys, the 10 hours going back and forth between Grand Rapids and Parsons. But it led to a lot of good things. Without these gentlemen, I'd never had that opportunity. Also, with Dick Barton and Gary Myers, we were three young freshmen who had started on the 1962 undefeated football team. And I tell you, there was a great team and a lot of great seniors on that team. My son Charlie's here with me this morning, and he reminded me, he said, Dad, I counted, there's only 38 guys on that team. Dick reminded me there were 38 good football players on that team. As you know, football is very important at Parsons. And you look back at the coaches we had, Dick and Gary and I were privileged to go to South Bend when Frosty Westring was inducted to the Hall of Fame. We reminded Frosty we got him his first 14 wins. Then Chela Huerta, another member of the Hall of Fame. And I have to mention Joe Lutz, who was here as a baseball coach, but served as the interim head coach in 1964. That year we were 6-3. One of our losses was the national championship team of Concordia of Minnesota. Coach Lutz was a hard-nosed ex-Marine. Football led me to the varsity club, where I was the president for 2 years. And that really gave me an opportunity to convince the school administration that the Letterman's Club could sell at the athletic events and take care of the concessions. Well, that set up a lot of starving athletes with a little income and opportunity for each varsity club member to receive a ring, which I probably wear for the last 60 years. Thinking back on that experience, I believe that was the start of my business career. Parsons gave me a chance, a full scholarship, but more than that, they gave me the confidence to become an Army officer, be smart enough to be sent to Germany for 2 years, then a year in Thailand, so I was close to it. Also, as well as become a really an entrepreneur, I haven't had a boss since 1975. I had a career in global logistics, supporting the automotive industry around the world. The opportunity to travel. I used to spend more time in Singapore than I did in Detroit. But it was a great, great run. Since the last 5 years, I've been flying athletic teams. We're now over 50 schools. And it's been quite an opportunity. I've also had the opportunity to give back to the community. Forgotten Harvest, I've been on their board in Detroit. They recover over 40 million pounds a year of food to give back to the community every day. David Faraday from the Golf Channel has a very active charity called Troops First. That charity helps wounded warriors. In the last year and a half, we provided over 20 service dogs to our veterans, most of them disabled or suffering from PTSD. The 60s were a great time at Fairfield, and I'll be grateful to the professors, the coaches, and the staff that made Parsons such a unique school. But I'd also be remiss not to mention some of my bros you saw in those pictures. You know, the Phi Sigs, it was an education in itself. The world is made up of all kinds, and they were all at the Phi Sig house. Thanks again to the Alumni Association for keeping the Parsons tradition alive. Thank you for coming.
Merlin Rosterman, class of 52. Merlin lives in a town of about 600. Over his 60-plus years in Ironton, Iowa, he virtually touched every resident. He's held almost every key position from mayor to a PT tax preparer. Merlin will be presented by his daughter, Monica Veros.
Well, I have papers too, but I can't read my own writing. But my name is Monica Veros, and I'm here to present my dad, Merlin Rosterman. I could go over some of the things that are already written in the bio, but quite honestly, I think that gives you a really good idea of what his professional life has been and somewhat of his social community giving has been. So the only thing I think I'm going to let you know is that he's great. He really is. He's stubborn, he's bullheaded, and he's a great motivator. Everything a kid really needed growing up. I guess I can say I had it. His motivation at times was rather interesting. He could look at you with principal eyes. Does anyone know what principal eyes are? They bug out about 2 inches out of your head. They get really, really big, and they scare you to death. There's still people that I went to school with that will say, oh my God, does he still do that principal eye thing? Well, he did. And he also used as a threat something that I learned on the way down. He actually got from the fraternity house at Parsons. This wooden board called the frat paddle. Well, he kept it around, I think, forever. It's probably still in the house. But he used that as a threat. Although I think at home he might have used it on me once or twice. But all in all, Dad has worked hard his whole life. Growing up, he never had one job. He always had at least two, sometimes three things going. That meant that we didn't see him sometimes very often because he might run off in the summer and do construction, or he'd be refereeing football, softball, basketball. Sometimes the only way we got to see him was if Mom would pack up the car and all of us would go to a game he was refereeing. But he did whatever he could and everything he could do to provide for his family, and we're just really proud of him. Not just for this honor that he's receiving from Parsons, but we've been proud of him forever. So with that said, I'm just going to say that I think when my dad reaches deep into himself and wonders if he has any regrets of things he may not have done in his life, I don't think he's going to have too many because he's had a great life and he has raised 3 successful children, and I think he's pretty happy all in all with everything that's gone on, and this honor is icing on the cake for him. So with that said, Merlin Rostermint, get your behind up here.
First of all, I'd like to thank Lee Kane for nominating me for this honor. Lee and I were friends. He called me and said, send me your resume, and which I did. And the committee, thank you for accepting this resume and giving me the honor tonight. Everybody came up here with papers. I came up with my letter sweater. It still fit. I left Parsons in 52 at 165 pounds. I showered the other day and stepped on the scale, 169. Now that's a good number of years. Yes, I try to maintain that, try to keep this sweater, which we found once again. Parsons meant a lot to me. You probably wonder, see, I went to Iowa State. I had a full ride to go to Iowa State to play basketball. The freshman played the varsity. Well, I took the ball away from a senior. That was a no-no. Next time down the floor, we weren't in the play, but I caught an elbow, and the sternum broke 3 ribs off my sternum. So that ended my career with Iowa State. And Dick Geith, who was also a member of our team at Manning, Iowa, when we won the state tournament, and our coach was a Parsons graduate, Bill Steniker, C.W. Steniker, whether, I don't know whether it's in the archives or not, but we convinced us to go to Parsons. We both got a full ride to play basketball, but we also ended up playing football. They talked me into doing that. I don't know why, but I did. But I played 2 years,
But Parsons was great for us. And I remember working in the cafeteria, in the lunch counter, doing dishes. You think I've probably done more dishes than a lot of people that went through the school. But I remember a lady that worked in the kitchen, a black lady, Debbie, was an Aunt Jemima. And when she laughed, there was so much of her that laughed. She remembered us fondly, and she was always baking a cake for us on the QT for some of her athletes, and we dearly loved her and corresponded with her. O.B. Nelson was our coach. I was not a clean ball player. I was too small to be a clean ball player. I played underneath the board on defense, 5'10", smallest guy on the starting line, but I had certain techniques that I worked. It worked for me. In fact, I had a referee one time. When a guy had the ball, I'd always take and poke him right in here. Referee said, "Rusterman, what's that?" Okay. So next time down the floor, I stood way back and I went through the motion. The whistle blew. I said, "What was that?" He says, "That's for the one I missed the time before." I couldn't argue that. But we enjoyed playing for Parsons. We had a good time. Bobby Harrison and I played together for 2 years. Joe Ferguson, Ron Kester, Dick Heath, starting five, Bud Backus, Ivan Helton, some of the Metropolis boys. We had a tremendous time. Bob was here. He too was an honoree. We played together. And I thank the committee. I will not forget Parsons. In my office, I have a plaque. I made who's who in the colleges and universities. I have plaques and things of Parsons in there. I did get my master's degree from USD in secondary administration. Taught for 17 years, went into the bank. I wasn't satisfied just working. I refereed for a number of years. You think that's easy sometimes? Put a stripes on and listen to the people. That's why you heard my whistle. I carry it as a reminder that I too had other jobs, as my daughter said, other than maybe teaching. I worked in construction. One summer, when I was a senior in high school, I spent 5 weeks showing cattle and hogs at the Illinois State Fair, Missouri State Fair, Iowa State Fair, Nebraska State Fair, sleeping in the barns. That's fun. If you think I want to go to the state fairs now, forget it. But it was enjoyable. So once again, I like to keep Parsons going. They're in my mind. Sure, I have a coat back there. I wore my letter sweater. I'm proud of it. Like I say, it still fits, and I was challenged to wear it today. Of which I did. Thanks for the committee. Thank you, Lee. This is a humbling experience.
Well done. Thank you, sir.
I'm proud of you. I'm really proud of you.
Jeff Stanley, class of 64. Imagine this: a grill, a countertop, and 10 bar stools in downtown Madison, Wisconsin. Shaq was all that Jeff Stanley needed to propel his restaurant hamburger to the number one ranking in the state of Wisconsin. Jeff will be introduced to the Wall of Honor by friend Biff Coomer.
And congratulations to all of the recipients today. It's wonderful. We keep the vision of Parsons alive. whether you know it or not, or whether we know it or not. Is it important? Yeah, I think it's important. And for those of you sitting out there, these recipients are a catalyst for other people to grow. If we listen to their messages, they all center around hard work. They center around being thankful. And they center around helping others. That's what this college left us with. And that's what Jeff Stanley does. Yeah, he's a good chef. Doesn't take much to flip a hamburger, but he's a good chef. He's done a remarkable job. I met him in 1962 and here at Parsons. And we didn't meet at Parsons. We met at a place down on 4th Street, and there was a booth or two back in there, and that's where we met. There were a lot of guys and gals who met down there. And I don't know, I think that's part of the legacy of at least the time that we were at Parsons, the Den, the TNC, those off-campus spots that probably didn't have a whole lot of social redeeming qualities connected with them. But nevertheless, it was part of our youth, I guess, and somewhat a rite of passage, if you will. Jeff and I went on a couple of trips together. He came to Milwaukee. He's from Beloit, Wisconsin. And he came down here in, I guess, 61 or 62. He graduated in 64. And he was a really good golfer. His dad was a coach at Beloit and was a golfer. And Jeff lettered in golf. You can read the synopsis of it that you all have. But he was a good golfer, and I'm sure that he still is. I haven't seen Jeff, physically haven't seen Jeff for 54 years until I saw him yesterday. The last time I talked to him was 3 years ago, and I had gotten the phone number from a fellow who was here last year, Paul Garrison, who introduced River Shannon into our wall. And Paul gave me the number, so I called Jeff. And he answers the phone, and he says, "Hello." I say, "Jeff, this is Biff Kummer." "Hey, Biff, how you doing?" I said, "I'm doing good." You know, expecting a nice talk. He says, "I got to go. I'm on the beach." That was it. And he left. I said, "Well, that's terrific." So here I am introducing him. Anyways, he and I went to Milwaukee back in, along with Steve Stans, Yogi Stans, and a guy named Denny Bruns, and Gary Ritter, Gary Goo from Waterloo. And we all went to Milwaukee to my home up there where I lived, I don't know, for whatever it was. And my mother pulled me over in the hallway upstairs and said, "Who is that guy?" And I said, "Well, that's Jeff Stanley. That's the Fang." And he said, "Who?" I said, "That's my friend." And then she goes, "Phew," just like that. She was that kind of like, "Holy cripe, son, who are you hanging out with?" Just kind of a, "Phew," like that. Anyways, I enjoyed it. She enjoyed it, and she loved the guy. And he was always, he has a sense of humor that's contagious, and one that is fun to be around. I never heard Jeff, and this is rare in today's world, I never heard Jeff talk behind somebody's back. And I think that's a pretty strong quality. He'd joke and what have you, but he never said anything demeaning about a person behind his or her back. And I think that's a real quality in an individual today. In the early 70s, Jeff had several opportunities to explore different jobs, and he did. In your booklet, it talks about he ran an antique shop, and he ran a gift shop, and he tried some little smaller businesses. And then he decided to find this hamburger place called Dottie Dumpling's Dowry. And that name, I asked him, I said, where did that name come from? That's a different name. And he said, it came from a guy named Jim Hersheimer. Jim Hersheimer is a Parsons graduate and ran antique shops. He had one down in, I think it was Galesburg, and somewhere else. And then he went over on the river, and he had one down Mississippi. And but anyways, he gave the name of the dowry to Jeff, and Jeff took it and ran with it. As you know, he started with a small operation, did very, very well, and in a very small confined area. And then through the government foresight and what have you, and clearing in downtown Madison over by the stadium, the right of eminent domain raised its head, and after a lengthy battle, of course, Jeff lost the battle, but in the long run, he won the war. Because he got another nice piece of property, location, 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 and from there, everything went upwards. And his daughter runs the operation today. It's a great place. I'm leaving. But I just want to show you Dottie Dumpling here, because when you're in Madison, you need to go here. It's a fantastic place, and that's what it is right there. So go eat, like we do here in Fairfield. Thank you very much, and I want to introduce to you Jeff Stanley. He is my pal, has been, and will be for a long time.
But anyway, after getting rejected from Stanford and Harvard, my mom called me and said I had a couple letters from Wofford Men's School in Parsons College, and I got accepted here at Parsons, and the Fairfield Parsons experience began. And I didn't come on a scholarship, and my stepfather found out when he fell in love with my mom that I came with her. So anyway, played the full boat. I don't know if I can read my notes here. I'm honored to be honored. And then I began in the class of 1875. And so I had quite a good time watching the city grow. And anyway, my experience is kind of a combination Parsons and Fairfield, between George's Pizza, Dr. Whitlock, the history department, the social department, and we even had a field trip to the Anamosas State Prison, where we really met some con artists. And anyway, I blew up my stepdad's car, eventually got it fixed in Anamosa and drove it back. But I don't have my teleprompter with me. And my glasses, where am I? Oh, I know, all the doctors we had were doctor this, doctor that. So I moved to Madison, and everybody's a doctor in Madison. So I named my two dogs Dr. Pepper and Dr. Freaky. And that's about it. I've just had a wonderful time in the five years I was here. And I like coming back and not knowing sometimes where I am. And I sure wish it was Parsons College. Thank you.
Dave Thompson, 71. I'm going to wave at the teleprompter. Dave is overseas. He's a member of the International Board of Directors of Volvo Truck, and he called from Rome this morning, so he's watching live streaming. Hi, David. Good to have you with us. Dave Thompson sold his first used truck for $1,200. Now, 40 plus years later, he owns 26 dealerships, 16 cities, over 5 states, and expects to do $740 million in this year. To call this an empire is an understatement. Friend and fraternity bro Frank Repass has the responsibility of presenting and accepting. Fraternity brother Eric Duffield didn't make it out of Florida with Matthew. West Palm Beach was being hit, so Frank, you're on to present and receive.
I feel like this is a sandlot pickup game, and I'm the last guy. I'm going to talk to Dave about changing his last name. Hey, Dave, and his wife, Ann. Good to see you. Also, John, we got Mike Condio is also watching, and other friends there. So glad to be here. Let's say good morning. I've got 2 minutes before it's afternoon. But I'm Frank Repass. Let us start by thanking Dave Neff and the committee members for making the past 7 years possible and to be here this today. It is an honor and a pleasure, though, being here to receive the award for Dave Thompson. Unfortunately, as they mentioned, could not be here because he's in Europe. Also, Dave's good friend, Eric, was supposed to be here also. The weather got a hold of him, so he could not make it. I want to talk about my first step on Parsons College campus in August of 1967. I graduated from high school at that time. I grew up on the East Central Florida in the shadows of the space program. Also lifeguarding at the beach, playing football. I was an 18-year-old kid. Like most kids, thought I knew everything. Actually, I'd never been out of the state except for a few visitations in Southwest Virginia. My parents were very hardworking. They never could afford sending me to college. I was the first person to attend college and to go. I was fortunate enough to receive a football scholarship, full ride. But it became more than of an education. I still have many friends because of my times here. There's a group of about 20 football players and other athletes that meet once a year, twice a year, down in St. Pete, Florida. So it's still an honor, and it's still very special for them. Nothing has changed, to say the least. When I first stepped on the campus, little did I know that my experiences here would open more doors than I could ever imagine. After graduating in 1971, I went to law enforcement. Now, I have to say that 1968, I walked around the square out here, part of the protest of Kent State. At that time, law enforcement, military, the war, and the attitudes were totally different. And I was walking around. And somebody said to me here at Parsons, they said, if you're going to change something, you have to change it from the inside. You can't do it from the outside. It's very difficult. So I went into law enforcement 40 years. I was honored to retire 25 years at the Orlando Police Department as a range master there and the primary firearms instructor, also followed by retiring from Kennedy Space Center. I do want to mention one other thing about law enforcement. Gets a little emotional. Give me a moment here. James Cornett, I want to thank you for what you do. Law enforcement, it's a bad name today, and I don't know why. And it shouldn't be. But there's about 100 cops killed a year, and about 3 to 4 times, sometimes 5 times, that amount of cops commit suicide. It's a very difficult job, to say the least. And it's getting tougher. Let's move on, and thanks for bearing with me on that. Dave Thompson came from a very modest upbringing with a single mom. I first met him my freshman year while pledging 5 sigs. Part of the pledging was walking 10 miles in sub-zero weather. He led the entire way. It was tough, to say the least. But anyway, we went on, and not saying that Dave had anything to do with, but we lost our chapter that year. But him, Eric, Duffield, and myself went on to join the WTBAs, and we became closer as the three amigos, learning, laughing, and growing together. Quick story about Eric Duffield. He played on the football team with me. He was a hard worker, ran hard, and one day he was running the bleachers. He pushed himself too much. He fell off the top of the bleachers, fell on his head. The coach comes running over to him. Eric, what happened? And his best football voice, Eric goes, "I don't know, coach, I just got here." Well, he's okay today, and he was. Another story about our senior year, David, Eric, and I moved into a small little apartment on the third floor of a house off campus. One Thursday night, Dave pulled up with this semi-truck parking in the parking lot. Kind of unusual, to say the least, being a college student. And Eric and I told him, "Hey, it's Thursday night, special beer night at the Den. We got to go." Dave says, "Nope, can't go. I got to work tonight. I got to drive." I said to Dave, "You knucklehead." I said, "That's a dead-end job, driving a truck, and you're going to go nowhere." Well, did he ever prove us wrong? So, 1976, after serving in Vietnam, Dave founded his company, Tech. In those days, he owned one dealership specializing in trucks. He already mentioned that his first truck he sold for $1,600 and to Wade Ranches, a still faithful customer today. First franchise was a factory-owned Mack dealership in Portland. Each year since then, past 22 years, he's opened approximately one dealership a year. He's up to 26 dealerships now. And his vision is he wants to own, only Dave can say that, he wants to own I-4, I-5 corridor. He's the only dealership to offer seamless service, extended hours along that 2,000-mile highway. Interestingly enough, though, the dealerships he's bought has either been bankrupt or losing thousands of dollars. Each dealership, though, has been rebuilt and maintained a profit. Dave today is joined by his three wonderful sons, and they all take an active role in his business. As you mentioned, $740 million a year with this company, starting by driving a truck. So pretty marvelous. He has locations in Washington, Oregon, California, Nevada. His many awards includes Dealership of the Year Award, Leading Dealer of Leasing, Oregon's top 100 companies. But something else is very important, as you've seen with the other honorees here, is giving back to the community. And he has. That's very important, and he's able to do that. His contributions are very important to him. He contributed to Oregon State, where all three of his sons graduated. Most valuable contribution was founding a vocational program at Portland Roosevelt High School in 1996. That's a school where many challenges include lower than average graduation rates, very diverse student body. More than 23 languages are spoken at this high school, if you can imagine. Mentoring program.
Do a wrap.
Okay. Almost done. Anyway, he trains his students and it allows them to go in the workforce, and then he sells the trucks, and it's donated to the schools. One other quick thing that he did back in 2010, if you remember the Haiti earthquake, one of his workers says, "What are you going to do about it?" He says, "Well, we got to do something." He started collecting money. He ended up getting his plane, got a hold of the medical teams international, and he ended up flying 7,000 miles across the country. He delivered 7 doctors, nurses, health professionals, and supplies. It cost him $35,000 in fuel alone. And one of the very unusual things there, he had a window. They only had one airport. He had a window of 20 minutes, and he had to be there from get there at 9:15 time slot, and he made it. These are just a few accomplishments that Dave has succeeded in his life, and he owes it a major part of it to Parsons. But at this time, it's an honor and pleasure to accept this award for my friend, my brother, David A. Thompson.
What a class. Very engaging, very exciting, very, very loyal and dedicated to the former days in Parsons College. What a class, and I really do hope you get a chance to exchange with them at the luncheon or wherever. So one last big hand for this great class here. You got, many of you were not here last year, but we instituted a new program over and above the helpers and the people that step forward and do things and also show their dedication and loyalty to Parsons and just never say no. They're always there when you need them, and they're people that just need to be recognized. So we created the Wildcat Spirit Award for these people. Last year, we had our first awardee, and this year, we're very proud to have our second awardee here. This is an at-random selection from the committee on people who just help out and do good stuff for us, which we are so grateful. And we're so grateful you were all here today. Special group, special distinguished careers, and certainly special that you guys showed up to honor them. So here to present this award, of course, is our president of the foundation, Mr. Dave Neff.
Our honoree has been an active supporter of our mission to perpetuate the legacy of Parsons College through the written word of the Parsons College e-news, or as a researcher and contributor, and assisting physically and financially with these annual Wall of Honor events. As a student, he graduated from high school in York, Pennsylvania, started his college career at John F. Kennedy College, Wahoo, Nebraska, and graduated from Parsons with the final class of 73. He was assistant women's basketball coach for the Parsons College Wild Kittens. Professional career as a recruiter for John F. Kennedy and also Parsons College. Most recently, he has been a polygrapher working with various branches of law enforcement and private entities where lie detector tests are essential. Over the past few years, he has financially underwritten the rental of this theater for our Wall of Honor events. He is the father of three children. Along with his wife, Judy, are proud grandparents of a covey of grandchildren. Parsons College Foundation Fund would like to welcome Ray Hamm Jr. to the podium. 2016 Spirit Award. We keep pushing forward. I'm going to make this brief. Those of you that got here early had a chance to see the Bar Height Chapel window, the angel window on the south side. This was completed and installed in 2013. The next year, Musco Lighting, fundraising, once again, from the alums, $13,000 was raised to move that forward. We have the Bar Height organ that many of you listen to. It's behind stage, and it is used for concerts here in the theater. And this was installed 6 years ago. It's a wonderful opportunity to share, and we would like to extend an invitation to all of you who have registered with us to join us for lunch at the Elks Lodge, located on the west side of the square. I will try and be down there to direct you if you don't know where it is. There is an elevator for those that would need it. Immediately following the unveiling of plaques in the Alumni Hall, we have a drape over that. And we want you to also think about the Carnegie Museum. If you didn't get to visit it yesterday, 1:30 p.m., that will be open and available. At this time, since it's not a seventh inning stretch, it's not quite the World Series yet, but I'd like you to rise and sing the alma mater that's on the back of your program, please.